blessed. And I, as we move on to the third panel, I would like to invite the moderator of the third panel, Dr. Bimal Sahani. He's the president-elect of SFM and he's a director of Scholar MD program for fetal medicine for radiologists. And he's an extremely brilliant teacher. Dr. Bimal, over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mohit. And I think there's... Yeah, we have the SFM. Yeah, okay. At the very onset, thank you, Northeast, and all the members of SFM Northeast for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this wonderful evening. And at the same time, hearty congratulations. This is your second virtual program that you're coming up with. And I'm really happy with the kind of efforts that are taken by your team there, and kudos to everyone there. And we now going to go into our third panel, and that is basically on something which we see on a day-to-day basis, and that is soft markers. Among those soft markers, the starting point for this is going to be case of aberrant right subclavian artery, which for all those who don't know, is also a soft marker for trisomy 21 and is a very, very important soft marker there. And for that, for case presentation, we have Dr. Gina Deka. She's a radiologist from Guwahati, and she's chief consultant at the Dispur Polyclinic and Hospitals, Guwahati. About Gina, I can only say one thing, is that she's one of the most multifaceted radiologists I have met in my life. Because, I envy her at times because she does MSK, she does fetal work, she does everything other than these two with the same zeal and the same passion and with the same level of expertise. And I wish I could do that in my life. And so that is one reason I envy her. And I hand over to Gina to share her slide and show us those cases of ARSA.
Sir, can I start?
Yeah.
Please. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Bimal, for those very kind words. First of all, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to the Society of Fetal Medicine for giving me this opportunity and privilege of presenting my case here. Today, I shall be talking on the aberrant right subclavian artery, or ARSA, its significance as a soft marker for prenatal aneuploidy screening, as well as how to go about counseling. The left aortic arch with an aberrant right subclavian artery, or the ARSA, is the most common abnormality or variant of the aortic arch, occurring in about 0.5 to 1.4% of the normal population. It is commonly associated with trisomy 21 in 14 to 20% of cases and other chromosomal anomalies, and it is a novel soft marker for evaluation of aneuploidy risk in the second trimester anomaly scan. It can be associated with cardiac and extracardiac malformations, and it can also be an isolated finding in 1% of fetuses with normal karyotype. Coming to the anatomy, we know that in a normal fetus, the aortic arch has got three branches, the brachiocephalic, which gives rise to the right subclavian and the right common carotid, then the left common carotid and the left subclavian artery. But in case of ARSA, the aortic arch has got four branches, starting from the right common carotid, the left common carotid, the left subclavian, and the ARSA most distally, which courses behind the trachea and the esophagus to go towards the right arm. So this can be well appreciated in a three-vessel tracheal view of the fetus, where we see the ARSA coursing behind the trachea. ARSA is a second trimester marker, and it has a likelihood ratio of positive likelihood ratio of almost 21.5 and an isolated likelihood ratio of 3.9. So today I shall be presenting two cases related to ARSA, and the second is a case of ARSA associated with other soft markers in a case of trisomy 21 and how to go about counseling these patients as well as advising the choice of tests. The first case is a 36 years old primie. She had an IVF pregnancy with self gametes. A 7 week scan showed a diamniotic twin pregnancy, but due to corona, she could not do an NT scan or a dual marker test. And she came directly for an anomaly scan at 19 weeks, 6 days. Dichorionic diamniotic twin pregnancy was noted. Fetus A showed a normal nuchal fold thickness and nasal bone, but there was a choroid plexus cyst present. And this prompted me to look for other structural anomalies very meticulously, because choroid plexus cyst might sometimes be associated with trisomy 18. Her four-chamber view showed an echogenic cardiac focus, and then her three-vessel view was normal. Other soft markers were normal, and this view of an open hand is very important to document, especially when we see a choroid plexus cyst, to rule out the clenched fist in a trisomy 18 case. Fetus B also showed normal structures, normal soft markers, like the nasal bone was present, the nuchal fold thickness was normal, there was no echogenic bowel, both umbilical arteries were present, there was no pyelectasis. But when we did the fetal echo, in the three-vessel tracheal view, we noticed the aberrant right subclavian artery, which both in the grayscale as well as in the color Doppler study. And this was seen as a vessel which was seen to course behind the trachea towards the right side of the shoulder of the fetus. So next comes the counseling part. We have a diagnosis where this mother is 36 years and her fetus A showed an echogenic intracardiac focus and a choroid plexus cyst, and a fetus B showed an isolated ARSA after ruling out all other structural anomalies or any soft marker in a meticulous manner. So since she did not have any dual marker test or a previous NT scan, the suggestion of a test to be done now was a bit of a dilemma, because we know that isolated ARSA per se, you know, has a very low risk for aneuploidy. And there is a debate going on whether to advise invasive, but considering that she has an increased risk because of her maternal age, she being 36 years, we suggested an amniocentesis. And why we did not, or why we suggested NIPT as a second option was because though NIPT has a very high detection rate in singleton pregnancies, its detection rate in twin pregnancies is not as high, and sometimes there might be a test failure rate of almost 13%. The patient was also very cooperative. She had these markers and she wanted a definitive diagnosis, and she decided to go for an amniocentesis. So amnio was done for both the twins, and samples were taken from both the cavities. And these samples were sent for QFPCR study. Finally, the amniocentesis report tested negative for aneuploidy in both the twins, and the patient is quite happy now. The second case is a 31-year-old primie. She also had a IVF conception, self gametes, no significant medical history. Her 7 week dating scan showed a single pregnancy with biometric correlating with her LMP. And she came for an NT scan at 11 weeks, 4 days, which showed a CRL of 62 mm, but her NT was increased to 3.3 mm. Her nasal bone was present and her intracranial translucency was normal. Flow across the tricuspid valve was normal, but however, there was a reversed A wave in the ductus venosus. And when we routinely saw the scans for the inflow and outflow in the four vessel view, as well as, you know, the three vessel view, there was the presence of an ARSA, which was noted in the three vessel view. So here we have a patient who has a high NT of 3.3 mm and a reversal of A wave in the ductus venosus. And though I did mention about dual marker test, but due to its limited role in such cases, I suggested a chorionic villus sampling, which would give a more comprehensive information about her chromosomes, but the patient was not very keen on doing an invasive. She opted for a dual marker test, and the dual marker showed an increased risk for trisomy 21, which was to the extent of 1:107. Then when she came back with her tests, amniocentesis was again suggested at 16 weeks, and the patient refused again. She was not keen for an invasive study, and she asked what was the next option. And so we said that she could do an NIPT and go for a second trimester anomaly scan. So she came for a second trimester anomaly scan at 19 weeks, 5 days, and this showed a second nuchal fold thickness of 7.8 mm. There was no ventriculomegaly, the nasal bone was present. Four-chamber view showed an echogenic cardiac focus. However, the rest of the fetal heart was normal. And on her three-vessel tracheal view, there was an ARSA, which was detected. And this was seen both in the grayscale image as well as the color Doppler study. So this is the video showing the same. We looked meticulously for the other soft markers or any other structural anomalies, and there was no pyelectasis, no echogenic bowel, femur and humerus lengths were normal. And she did come with an NIPT report, which again showed a high risk for T21. So without doing an amniocentesis, the patient terminated the pregnancy. So to conclude, ARSA is a novel soft tissue marker for prenatal screening of T21, and it can be detected as early as the first trimester, and it can be isolated or associated with other soft markers as well as cardiac and extracardiac structural anomalies. Invasive testing is advised in patients having a high risk in isolated ARSA and even those associated with other significant soft markers. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Gina. Thanks a lot. Wonderful cases, wonderful imaging. And now, can you unshare your screen, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much. So now we move to the panel. And this panel is not just going to be about ARSA. We're going to move from ARSA to the other second trimester soft markers. And I have a wonderful group of panelists here. To begin with, of course, Gina, I've introduced her, and so she doesn't require another introduction. Dr. Apurva Kumar Bhattacharya, who is an associate professor of OBGY at Jorhat Medical College. He's got a lot of publications in different index journals and postgraduate textbooks. And he's been involved in organizing a lot of regional, national, and international conferences. A great academician, and we are fortunate to have him here. Then we have Dr. Tomar Basar, who is an obstetrician from Manipur, and he's assistant professor in the TRIHMS Medical College, Arunachal Pradesh. Then we have Dr. Deepika Morang, a radiologist with special interest in fetal medicine, and she is a consultant radiologist in Crystal Diagnostic Center Nalbari, Assam. Dr. G.S. Rudrapal is an obstetrician with postdoctoral fellowship in fetal medicine. So he's a consultant fetal medicine at Woodland Hospital, Shillong. And we have, Dr. Himamani Deka. She is professor, Guwahati Medical College, and a genetist and trained in genetics at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, and immunogenetics in the PGIMER. And so we have a genetist here. She's received a lot of awards and recognition. So with this wonderful panel and with Gina having started with ARSA, so we begin with ARSA. And as she's rightly pointed out, that normally the aortic arch gives you four vessels. And if you are finding that, what happens in aberrant right subclavian artery is that you have, normally you have the brachiocephalic artery, which divides into the right subclavian artery and the right common carotid. But in ARSA, what happens is that the right subclavian artery arises as the fourth vessel and goes behind the trachea and goes towards the right arm. Now, Gina, I wanted to ask you, because there is already a question on the chat box, you said yes, you from the 3VT view, and then you move and you see the ARSA. See, our normal settings are based on what we see as for our atrioventricular valves and our outflow tracts. But can you see an ARSA in that, or do you require very specific settings for that? Dr. Gina?
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you, sir, for that question. For an ARSA, we have to, it is usually seen in color Doppler, and for that, we have to reduce the velocities to 10 to 15 centimeters per second. And so we usually see it at the presets for venous flows. And it is always advisable, to have a separate preset in our machines, which will detect all these low flows like an ARSA.
So yeah, honestly speaking, if you have a setting of for venous flows, you can use the same settings here and you can look for it. And as she's shown in her cases, this is the three vessel tracheal view. So in the 3VT view, an ARSA would be seen as a vessel which goes behind the trachea. So it goes behind the trachea and it goes straight towards the right shoulder. That is an aberrant right subclavian artery. Now, what are the, other than the 3VT view, are there any other planes in which you can diagnose or rule out ARSA?
Yes, we can see ARSA in a coronal view where we see both the subclavian arteries arising from the aortic arch. And then we can see it in the bicycle handlebar view. And usually the subclavian artery is seen, the normal subclavian artery is seen coursing anterior to the trachea towards the right side of the arm.
Yeah, so the normal right subclavian artery you would see after, actually in if you're going from caudocranially, once you have left the 3VT view, that is the time when you can see the right sub normal right subclavian artery, which is an S-shaped structure, and you would see that going from above the trachea. It would be anterior to the trachea.
But and so we can also, excuse me, we can also see it in the sagittal view, I think, sir.
Yes, you can also see it in
the sagittal. We can see the four vessels arising from the aorta.
Aorta, yeah. And there is a new sign which has come up in 2020 from the, there is an Israeli group which has come up with a wonderful study where they called it the no ARSA sign. And they have labeled it as a novel method of prenatal screening for aberrant right subclavian artery. The point that they are trying to make is that if you follow the conventional method, of course, the conventional method is the 3VT view, and it is still a gold standard because it is validated. But what they felt was that it at times can be overlooked because of acoustic shadowing. So what they felt is that to, ARSA can be ruled out by demonstrating the brachiocephalic artery bifurcation. And this, they called it as the no ARSA sign. So that, that's the brachiocephalic artery, and that's the one which is bifurcating. And I will just show you one clip. So, the fetus should be in a supine position with a slight right-sided tilt. Obtain the three-vessel tracheal view. From the 3VT view, what you need to do is do a slight rotation of the transducer towards the sagittal plane. And once you do that, you will be able to see the brachiocephalic artery. And if you, turn the transducer more sagittally, you would see the bifurcations. So you will be seeing the bifurcation. I will show you the clip here. And there you can see that's the brachiocephalic artery which is coming, and then it bifurcates, and it bifurcates into the right common carotid artery and the right subclavian artery. The right common carotid artery goes straight up towards the neck, whereas the right subclavian artery goes posterior laterally towards the arm. So this is what they have called as the no ARSA sign. And if you see this bifurcation, you have ruled out an ARSA. So that is a new thing which has come in. I've tried it in a few cases, and you all can start working. And once this is validated, by many people, probably this would come as a good sign. Okay. Now, Dr. Rudrapal, what is the significance of ARSA in relation to aneuploidy?
Good evening, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, very much.
Yes. So, aberrant right subclavian artery, as madam has already said, is the commonest aortic arch variant or abnormality, whatever we call it. So, it is considered as one of the soft markers of Down syndrome. And however, one to 1.5% of euploid fetuses, it can be seen as an ultrasound finding. In around 20 to 25% of trisomy 21 fetuses with trisomy 21, this can be a finding. When associated with other soft markers, it has got a likelihood ratio of 21. However, as isolated marker, it has got a likelihood ratio of 3.9. We must remember that and understand that not only trisomy 21, it can be associated with other cardiac anomalies as well. Specifically, when it is associated with the conotruncal anomalies, we should think of Dijort syndrome or 22q microdeletion. So in that case, when we think about genetic diagnosis, we should perform or go for a microarray rather than a karyotype.
Thank you, Dr. Rudrapal. Now, Dr. Himamuni, she's a genetist here. Isolated ARSA, is invasive testing mandatory?
Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are.
Good evening, sir. Sir, isolated ARSA itself is not mandatory for invasive testing, as it is not associated with aneuploidy. But we have to assess for the patient condition and the other risk factors that should be evaluated before going for some invasive procedures, sir.
Yeah. See, what I want to tell the delegates is this likelihood ratio of ARSA isolated, which has come as 3.9. This is all coming from a meta-analysis which was done in 2012 by Agatha Kloss and Nicolaides group. In fact, if you read that article, as regards ARSA is concerned, though it was a meta-analysis of multiple studies, but as far as ARSA is concerned, in 2012, there were very few studies that had come, and most of the studies had come from tertiary level centers. So probably that is the reason that the likelihood ratio of isolated ARSA has come so high. Now, there are recent articles which have come in. As far as ARSA isolated is concerned, there are clear cut. They say that isolated ARSA does not seem to be associated with a significantly increased risk of aneuploidy. However, the possibility of fetal karyotyping, which is more invasive procedure, should be discussed in the light of overall risk of the fetus. There's another article which came in 2017, which said that as an apparently isolated finding, ARSA is benign and not associated with trisomy 21 or Dijort syndrome. The finding of ARSA, however, warrants a detailed fetal ultrasound. All fetuses with ARSA and genetic anomalies had additional ultrasound findings in their large study also. But in a setting of a high-risk pregnancy, then genetic testing is recommended. Like if you see in Gina's both the cases, In one case, of course, you had a nuchal translucency, which was already 3.3. There was a wave reversal in ductus venosus, and then there was an ARSA. So they were already, you know, with just based on a nuchal translucency of 3.3 itself, I would have said actually, yes, what she had suggested was the right thing at that moment, only to do invasive testing CVS. But as she pointed out, unfortunately, the patient didn't opt for that. And that is why it all went down to an NIPT in the second trimester. In her other case, yes, though ARSA and echogenic focus, there were two findings. It does happen that when you have, because the mother was 36 years of age, she is already high risk by age. So in a setting of a high risk pregnancy, yes, you have to think in terms of genetic testings. Yeah. Now, Dr. Tomer, whenever we think of aneuploidy, you know, whenever we think of soft markers, screening, why are we so worried about Down syndrome? We don't worry that much about the other aneuploidies. We always, even if you look at all the research which has been done on soft markers, you will find that most of it is done for Down syndrome. Why is that?
Good evening, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, sir. Down syndrome is the one of the commonest aneuploidy in terms of live birth. Say some people are saying 1 in 650, some are saying 1 in 750. It's a very high, and among these also only 33% of Down syndrome have major anomalies. So we are going to miss it, and of course they have long lifespan, and the quality of life is the main issue here. Like they need somebody to assist in their life. So in our society, some people can afford it, but in majority of the Indian society, because of poor socioeconomic condition, they have difficult to support their children. This is the main issue, crux of the Down syndrome, sir. And about like other anomalies like trisomy 13, 18, we can detect easily, and majority of them express about 90 to 95% have the major congenital anomaly, which can be detected easily. If at all miss also, they die in utero and the immediate perinatal death is there. So Down syndrome, we have to support in their lifespan. That is the main concern. And because of our socioeconomic condition, we have to detect them early, sir.
Yeah. And it's not necessary that, okay, you know, the best part is that once, even if you have diagnosed Down syndrome, it is important that the parents should know about it. And then they are able to make a right decision whether they would want to continue with this pregnancy. They would like, there are people who have no problems with having a child with Down syndrome. And in fact, we are also seeing that a lot of these babies with Down syndromes have been doing, achieving great thing in life. But yes, as you rightly pointed out, they require support. They require special schools, all these things. And not everyone probably would want to go for it. And that is the reason we need to. And other aneuploidies will actually show you so many structural anomalies, which we all are very good with. Whereas for Down syndrome, we need all these soft markers and the screening and the biochemical markers and everything. Dr. Apurva, he talked about major anomalies, major markers, and then we have these soft markers. Like Gina said that ARSA is a soft marker. So what is actually a soft marker?
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Good evening, very sir. Much, sir.
Yeah. Marker is a dysmorphic fissure. Incidence in aneuploid fetus is more than incidence in euploid fetus, and it's a variant of normal. It do not constitute a structural effect. Rather, it is often transient whenever it occurs. And presence of a marker increases the risk of a chromosomal anomalies, but it does not confirm. And absence of markers decreases the risk of chromosomal abnormalities, but it does not rule out. So soft tissue markers are fetal sonography findings. That is not a structural abnormality. It is an abnormality of you will have to see whether it is transient or it remains, it is persistent or not. That is the thing.
So marker actually is a dysmorphic feature. What he said is whose incidence in aneuploid fetus is greater than that in euploid fetuses. So it is not that they are present only in aneuploid fetuses. If they would have been present only in aneuploid fetuses, they would not have become markers. They would have become diagnostic stuff. So they are present in euploid, they are present in aneuploid, but if their incidence is higher in aneuploid than euploid, then we call them as markers, and they are actually variations of normal. They are not structural anomalies. They can be transient, but their significance does not go away. Now, what are the second trimester soft markers of aneuploidy? Dr. Rudrapal, I want you to, you know, tell me which are the markers which actually now are established as the soft markers, second trimester soft markers for trisomy 21. And then, of course, we will see some other markers also.
Sir, there are 8 markers of trisomy 21, which we can see in second trimester. Those are increased nuchal fold thickness, unossified or absent nasal bone, mild ventriculomegaly, mild pyelectasis, echogenic intracardiac focus, short humerus or short femur, aberrant right subclavian artery, and echogenic bowel. And of course, some authors have described some other soft markers also. Those are choroid plexus cyst, single umbilical artery, and megacisterna magna. We must understand that those three are not soft markers for trisomy 21. Choroid plexus cyst is associated with trisomy 18, whereas single umbilical artery is more of a non-specific and controversial soft marker. It is
we'll be discussing that ahead. Now, in which plane do we, Dr. Deepika? Now, this is a quick fire round. There are 8 questions which are going to come very, very quick fire, and I want the panelists to just let me know specific answers. Which plane do we measure the nuchal fold thickness, and what is the cutoff?
Sir, we measure the nuchal fold thickness in the transcerebellar plane, where the CSP, cerebellum, and the occipital bone is visible. And we place the caliper at the outer margin of the skin and the outer margin of the occipital bone. And sir, we take 6 mm as the cutoff point between 18 to 21 weeks, and some takes cutoff 5 mm as between 15 to 18 weeks.
Yeah, there is a group of people who feel that before 18 weeks, between 15 to 18 weeks, we should use 5 millimeter as a cutoff. Now, Dr. Himamuni, you're genetist, so I want to ask you one question. You know, of course, we all know what an unossified nasal bone is, but unossified nasal bone and hypoplastic nasal bone.
Sir, if there is hypoplastic nasal bone, it increases the likelihood of trisomy 21. And if there is a hypoplastic nasal bone is present, that increases maybe the association and likelihood of trisomy 21 incidence.
No, what my question is that do they carry the same significance or their significance is different?
Significance is different, sir. If there is hypoplastic nasal bone, that is, there is more chance or more likelihood of a presence of trisomy 21.
And unossified nasal bone?
Sir, this is this may be because of some other factors can be associated, and that can be sir racial variation or other environmental factors can also affect.
You know, even if it's an unossified nasal bone or an hypoplastic nasal bone, we would still call, you know, put them together, you know, use the same likelihood ratio for both. We normally do not differentiate, and if it is unilateral or bilateral, you know, does the significance change? Because at times you just see unossification on one side, whereas the other side is ossified. Does the significance differ then? Or the significance is the same?
Sir, depending on the race and the week of gestation, this ossification will be different, sir.
Yeah, okay. See, what basically, you know, whether it's unilateral, bilateral, unossified, hypoplastic, yes, hypoplastic, you know, a lot of people initially thought only if it is unossified, then only it has a higher risk with aneuploidy. But, you know, hypoplastic nasal bone carries, in fact, as you rightly say, for T21, that would actually probably be a more stronger this thing. Now, does the nasal bone length differ in different population of different ethnicity?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It does differ. Yeah. So before you call it as hypoplastic nasal bone, you cannot use a universal cutoff that we, you know, use in the sense which is coming from the Caucasian population. So there is a difference between the fifth centile of the Indian standards and the Caucasian standards. So you can always go into some calculators like perinatology.com, where you have to put in the ethnicity, the region where you belong to, and then you put in the gestational age and the nasal bone, and that tells you where it fits into. Now, Gina, madam, when do you call a bowel echogenic?
Yes, sir. Yeah. A bowel is called echogenic when its echogenicity is similar to or more than the surrounding bone. And we usually compare it with the iliac bones. And
any specific technical changes that you should make when you are, because you may be using a C2-9 probe, and would you want to change over or before you label it?
We need to switch off harmonics, sir. And sometimes we need to reduce the gain. And sometimes, you know, we have to keep reducing the gain so that, you know, we see only the bones, the echogenicity of the bones. And then if we still see, you know, the bowel to be echogenic, then we say that it is echogenic bowel.
Yeah, but we need to use transducers of 5 megahertz or less, you know, because with the higher frequency transducers with tissue harmonics, you would normally find a lot of it. And the other causes, of course, could be swallowed blood, cystic fibrosis, and maternal infection. Now, DP, when do you call a femur or humerus short as a marker for Down syndrome?
So when the femur length is less than 2.5th percentile, or there is another method, we take the ratio of observed by expected length. Then if it's less than 0.9, then we say it is a short femur. And again, about short humerus, it is again, if it is less than 2.5 percentile or measured to expected ratio is less than 0.89. And while considering as a soft marker, we consider only one of them. We don't take together the short femur and the short humerus, because this may be present in constitutionally small fetus.
Yeah. If so, isolated short femur or isolated short humerus is a marker for Down syndrome. Now, Dr. Apurba, what is an echogenic intracardiac focus and what is its significance in the Indian population?
It's a hyperechoic focus in the region of papillary muscle of the heart, and this echogenicity is comparable to the bone. It's seen in around 25% of the Asian fetuses. So echogenicity is in the left ventricle is about 88% and 5% in case of right ventricle, and biventricular around 7%. So it has got less significance in Indian population.
Very true, because actually it's very commonly seen in the Asian population. Yes, so, you know, we will come into it. What is its likelihood ratio, which we will come later on. And Dr. Tomar, how do you define a mild ventriculomegaly?
Mild ventriculomegaly is usually measurement of atrium of lateral ventricle, which measurement is more than 10 mm and less than 15 mm. So measurement is very important. I want to point out here, sir, is in a transventricular plane, one of the important plane in the neurosonography. And how do we place the caliper also is very important. It is placed inside to inside, just like we measure the nuchal translucency. On the medial side, there is parieto-occipital sulcus to make as a marker, and we measure at the glomus, and our caliper should be perpendicular to the ventricle.
Very true, sir. It's very important. It's not about just what reading you're getting, but have you measured it properly? Because a normal, you know, anything less than 10 is normal, and 9, it could just be 9.7, but if you have not measured it properly, you could make it 10.2 and then think of it as a soft marker. Deepika, what is the cutoff of renal pelvis AP diameter do you use as a marker for T21? Deepika?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please, so, quick fire.
Sir, to measure the AP diameter, we take the transverse section of the abdomen at the renal pelvis level, and the AP diameter, we more than 4 mm, we take as the cutoff, sir.
Thank you. And you know, now we move to these, you know, three, four other markers. Dr. Rudrapal, what is choroid plexus cyst and what is its significance? Because this is one marker which actually you see so regularly. And I think this becomes a, you know, something, because the moment you tell the patient there is something in the brain. So it's very important that everyone should, not just the people who are doing the imaging, but everyone should know what is the significance of a choroid plexus cyst.
Choroid plexus is a well circumscribed fluid filled spaces within choroid plexus. It is seen in up to 2.5% of normal population as an isolated finding during 16 to 20 weeks of gestation if we conduct the scan. However, after 23 weeks of gestation, they start spontaneously regressing, and it is very uncommon to find them after 25 or 26 weeks of gestation sonographically. It is considered as a soft marker. However, the points to remember, number one is that it does not matter whether it is unilateral, bilateral, single, multiple, whether it is regressing in the subsequent scan or not, it does not increase the risk of aneuploidy in the fetus. Number two, it is not a soft marker of trisomy 21. It is associated with trisomy 18. When it is as an isolated finding, it increases the background risk of trisomy 18 1.5 times. Having said that, trisomy 18 is a condition which is seen with a spectrum of associated disorder. So when we find choroid plexus cyst ultrasonographically, it becomes an indication of further detailed evaluation of the anatomy of the fetus, not a direct indication of amniocentesis itself. So,
isolated CPC, would you like to do any genetic testing? Isolated?
No, sir. I would never so go ahead. Yeah. In a low-risk setting, in fact, I'll reassure the mother that it is just a finding. It is not an abnormality. It will regress spontaneously. And if she wants further reassurance, I will call her for a subsequent scan after 20.
You said that it regresses by 25 weeks. So will you call her again to confirm whether it has regressed or not?
Yes, sir. To document itself and also to allay her apprehension that it has regressed. It is not there anymore.
Yeah. So otherwise, yes, it's not required. But yes, to, you know, it will make her comfortable that it's no more there. Thank you very much. You have taken us very nicely through the CP cyst. So isolated CP cyst, if you're sure you have seen all the anatomy and if you have ruled out a clenched fist, very important thing, which, you know, 50% of trisomy 18 would have a clenched fist. Now, Deepika, what is the significance of a single umbilical artery as a marker for aneuploidy?
Sir, isolated single umbilical artery has no strong association with aneuploidy. But yes, if a single umbilical artery is seen, it warrants a thorough anatomical survey of the fetus, because most of the time it is associated with cardiac defects, renal defects, or sometimes esophageal atresia also. If these cardiac defects are present, then it also warrants aneuploidy screening again. And for isolated single umbilical artery, usually we do not advise invasive testing.
It's also associated with SG and FGR, so yes, you need to follow them up later on.
Okay. Yes, sir.
And Gina, what is the association of megacisterna magna with aneuploidy? What is its significance as an isolated finding?
Megacisterna magna can be found in trisomy 18, but for that, as Dr. Rudrapal has rightly pointed out, we do see a spectrum of anomalies. And as an isolated finding, it is not associated. I mean, there is no association with aneuploidy. And at this point, I would also like to mention that when we measure the cisterna magna, we have to do it in the correct plane so that there is no, you know, the measurement is correct, because we call it a cisterna magna only when it is mega cisterna magna, when it is only greater than 10 mm in the AP diameter. So it is also very important to measure it correctly. And yes, I mean, there is isolated MGM has no association with aneuploidy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Himamani, there are some other things which are used as markers, like fifth finger clinodactyly, increased iliac angle, short ear, sandal gap. Yes, I know they all have their significance, but do we use this as our routine markers?
No, sir. They are not very reproducible and consistent, so they are not included in the routine screening protocols in low-risk patients, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Now, this is the meta-analysis that I was talking about. This is one of the charts which Gina showed you, that with these eight markers for Down syndrome, you have the positive likelihood ratio, the negative likelihood ratio, and the likelihood ratio if these findings are isolated. Now, wait, how, you know, it's very important that we know how these, you know, likelihood ratio of a marker has come when it is isolated. Now, what happens is, if there is any marker, you take the positive likelihood ratio of that marker and multiply with the negative likelihood ratio of all the other markers. So if there is an echogenic intracardiac focus, the positive likelihood ratio is 5.83. Now what you do is you multiply the negative likelihood ratio of all other markers, except, you know, either use short humerus or short femur, because if both, she pointed out that if both are pressed short, then we don't take them as a marker. And then you multiply you have the negative likelihood ratio of all other markers, and you multiply this, the likelihood ratio of EICF would eventually come down to 0.95. So that is actually the method, but you have softwares which are available where you can just click on the both the markers or one marker, and you will find it will give you what is the likelihood ratio for that. But doctor, now if you look, see, the important thing is when you are multiplying with the negative likelihood ratio of all other markers, you should have seen them, that they are not present. If you have not looked for one particular marker, then you can't include that in the risk calculation. Now, this is what happens. People see most of the markers, but the majority of the people actually do not look for ARSA. If they have not looked for ARSA, then you cannot include the negative likelihood ratio of ARSA in the calculation. So if ARSA you have not seen, then you will find that even the likelihood ratio of ventriculomegaly, which is 3.81, becomes 5.36. And that is the reason, you know, it's not just very easily said that, okay, the likelihood ratio of this is just 1.65 echogenic bowel. But that is if you have ruled out all other markers. If you have not looked for some marker, that marker negative likelihood ratio is not to be taken into calculation. And if you don't take that into calculation, you will find that the likelihood ratio of the marker as an isolated finding will be more than what we are showing in the charts. And that is why it's important to understand all this. Now, Dr. Rudrapal, it's very simple. Everybody of us has got this chart on our tables. If there is an isolated marker, we just look into it and write down, yes, as an isolated finding, its likelihood ratio is this. But there are so many times you have multiple markers. Then how do you calculate the likelihood ratio if there are multiple markers?
Sir, we go about the same way. Say we have marker A and B present. So we'll take the positive likelihood ratio of A, multiply that with the positive likelihood ratio of B. At the same time, we multiply the negative likelihood ratio of B, C, D, whatever was not present. When we combine them together, we get the final risk, and we can modify that it further with the age-adjusted risk or whatever the a priori risk we have.
Yeah, I'll just show you an example. Mild hydronephrosis and ventriculomegaly, two markers present. So the combined positive likelihood ratio of this is this 210. And then you multiply with the negative likelihood ratio of the remaining markers, excluding these two. And then you multiply these two, the combined positive likelihood ratio and the combined likelihood negative likelihood ratio. And you get this reading. So now, see, this is as the number of markers increase, the likelihood ratio increases, and hence the risk keeps on increasing. So a single marker may not be very significant, but if there are two markers or three markers, the likelihood ratio increases. And once the likelihood ratio increases, then the risk increases. So for mild hydronephrosis, you know, we say it is closer to one, so 1.6 and all, we don't give it that much of a significance. But now when present with some other marker, this becomes 31.5, and that increases the significance. Thank you very much for taking us through that. And Dr. Deepika,
thank you.
Now, okay, this is the second trimester scan. We have talked about markers. We have the likelihood ratio. Now, for that particular fetus, how do you estimate the risk then?
So to estimate the risk, first we have to know the what is the a priori risk. See, first the a priori risk may be the maternal age related risk if she has not done the first trimester combined test. And if she has done the combined test, and the combined test will give her an adjusted risk. So that will, risk will be a priori risk for us when we estimate the risk in second trimester. For example, if maternal age-related risk is 1 in 500, and after combined test, it has become 1 in 700, then we will take 1 in 700 as the a priori risk. Then we look for the presence of the soft marker. If only single marker is present, then we take the isolated likelihood ratio. And if two or multiple markers are present, then we calculate the combined risk as you have already told. And then we apply this like combined likelihood ratio or the isolated likelihood ratio to the adjusted risk given by the combined test or by the maternal age a priori risk, whatever it is. Then we calculate the risk. If the risk becomes 1 in 250, which is taken as the cutoff in our Indian population, then we advise the patient to go for invasive testing.
Thank you. The most important point that you have made here, which I want every delegate to go home with, is that, the of course, you know, the starting point always for any risk assessment starts with the age-related risk. But age-related risk is not the, you know, is the starting point. But if already you have got a first trimester screening done, or any kind of a screening has been done, and you have, once you have adjusted a risk, then when you are adding any other marker, the previously adjusted risk becomes the a priori risk. So this is very important. Even when you are doing biochemistry, if you have already done a dual marker, and then there are so many patients who get a dual marker done, they get a quadruple marker done. The dual marker has been done and a risk is given, quadruple has been done and a risk is given. That is where the whole essence of the screening goes for a toss. So you cannot have multiple risks coming. So if an FTS has been done, then yes, that risk is your, you know, you've already adjusted the risk. After that, any marker, even if you're doing a quadruple, then that first trimester risk should become your a priori risk. And then you need to modify that a priori risk with all any other marker that you add after that. Thank you very much, Deepika. And for example, like, so, and you know, suppose the risk is 1 in 759 and the likelihood ratio is 1. What we are trying to say is that the risk for the patient, you know, for the fetus remains 1 in 759 because the likelihood ratio is 1. But if the likelihood ratio is 3.8, that means the risk is increasing by 3.8 times. So the risk, which was 1 in 759, now becomes 1 in 200. So this is how the, you know, all these calculations are actually done. But fortunately for us, everything is based on softwares now. But it is very important that we should understand the concept of all this. Dr. Himamni, does absence of any marker in the second trimester scan alter the risk?
Yes, sir. If there is absence of any marker or normal scan, it decreases the this risk and anomaly by many folds, sir, around 7.7.
7.7 is based on this calculation.
Yes, like, sir.
You know, from like- You multiply the negative, because there is no likely positive, there is no positive marker. So you multiply the negative likelihood ratio of all the markers, that becomes 7.7. But ideally speaking, that requires a very high level of expertise to reduce it that much. There are other studies which have shown a combined negative likelihood ratio of 0.33. So to be on a safe side, you can reduce the a priori risk by 3.3 times. For example, if the age-related risk was 1 in 80, and first trimester screening was done, and the risk after FTS was 1 in 450, the patient still does not want to go, though it is an intermediate risk, does not want to do an NIPT, does not want to do anything further, still wants to wait for the second trimester scan. And if the genetic sonogram is normal, you know, the risk reduces by 3.3 times. And so, you know, that would be a little reassuring to the mother. Now, if FTS has not been done, Dr. Apurva, if there has been no screening, this is a real life scenario. There are so many times patient ends up directly in the second trimester to an obstetrician. Yes. Then how would you screen a patient for Down syndrome, sir?
Yes, sir. If first trimester scan is not done, the risk assessment is done by a combination of biochemical markers, that is quadruple markers and ultrasound markers, both combination of both quadruple and ultrasound markers to be offered to the patients.
Yeah, and if
it commonly patient... happens, many patients. Yes, sir.
Then yeah, please yes, go sir. Ahead, sir. Please go ahead.
It commonly happens because many patients, suppose in a periphery, they do not feel to do one first trimester scan. So we are now giving importance to the first trimester to see the markers also, soft tissue markers and the nuchal transcutaneous anti-scan is very much important to, for screening of Downs and other chromosomal abnormalities.
If the patient is affording and, you know, will it be okay if she can go for an NIPT, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, if a patient can afford, we can go for NIPT also.
Yeah, that also is an option that we need to give to the patients. Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Now,
yes.
Is Dr. Rudrapal, is there a role of genetic sonogram after first trimester screening?
Sir, genetic sonogram has got a detection rate of 69% for a false positive rate of 5%. Now, should we conduct it routinely after first trimester screening? Well, initial data has been positive. Research has shown that it substantially increases the detection rate of Down syndrome, either due to detection of early anomalies or soft markers or a combination of both.
Very true. So basically, the second trimester gives you an extra option for looking for the, you know, the major markers also. But yes, in this study by Boomley et al., they in fact found out that, yes, 33% of them were picked up in the second trimester. Five out of, you know, out of the 14, five were with structural anomalies and all the rest had at least one soft marker. So there is definitely a role for genetic sonogram even after first trimester screening. And Dr. Tomar, if a patient has a screen negative NIPT, has already got an NIPT done, and there are soft markers in the second trimester, will you modify the risk? Dr. Tomar?
No, sir. Yes, sir. By close and going further, there is very research work. They found that there is no relation between fetal free cell DNA and the soft marker. So I mean to say that
we are actually okay. You know, I will take, you know, there are clear guidelines which say that in a woman who have had a cell-free DNA testing, the association between isolated soft markers and aneuploidy risk is generally no longer relevant. So if the patient has already undergone an NIPT, then don't go about modifying the NIPT risk with the soft markers. There is no role. This is actually an executive summary of, you know, the office or the bearers of the Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine, AIUAM, American College of OBGY, American College of Radiologists, all these put together, they have come up with this statement. So we need to follow that. Now, Imamani, risk modified, you have a new risk. What cutoff would you use for further testing? What test would you recommend and why?
Sir, if there are risk factors in NIPT and the patient have other risk association like increased maternal age or family history like that, then the patient can be further advised for other invasive procedures and the genetic testing like karyotyping, FISH, microarray, quantitative PCR, all those can be further advised to go for the confirmed diagnosis.
Yeah, but which among these would you go for? Suppose she's 19 weeks, 4 days, and she's got two soft markers, and her new modified risk is coming to say 1 in 200. What test would you like to her to go for?
Sir, qPCR, this qFPCR will be the first option.
Yeah, why qFPCR?
Sir, cell-free DNA, if it is confirmed, then, sir, no need to go for the other procedures.
Okay, yeah, qFPCR we need to do for a quick, because she's 19 weeks, 4 days, and we want a rapid, this thing, a qFPCR, which should be followed by a, you know, microarray or a conventional karyotype, depending upon what you're finding. A microarray these days is a, you know, a better option that we opt for. Yeah, Dr. Apurba, how do you counsel a patient with soft markers? The patient has come from Dr. Gina, and she's already written that this is a marker which is present and the risk is, so say, 1 in 200. How do you counsel this patient?
Yes, sir. It is very important to counsel the patient, because we'll have to counsel in that the presence of marker does not mean that it's a presence of Down syndrome or other syndromes, other chromosomal abnormalities, or absence of marker does not mean that it is absent of Down syndrome. So whatever we are playing as the risk factors. So it is, if it is 1 is to 200, suppose the risk factor, whenever you calculate, is, it does not mean that it means only 1%, that is 1/199 baby chances of euploid baby is there always. So an ultrasonography cannot point out to it as early testing is as possible. So we'll have to give the option for invasive testing whenever we get any presence of soft markers or any risk factor increases.
No termination of pregnancy based just on soft markers.
No, right, no, sir? No, sir. We'll have to go for invasive testing. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. Now, Dr. Tomar, there is a group of people who feel that we need to stop reporting markers such as EICF and choroid plexus cyst, because they feel that, you know, presence of these markers, they actually increase the anxiety rather than any benefit, and their likelihood ratio is just close to one. So they are actually not increasing the a priori risk at all. So what is your take on this, Dr. Tomar? I hope his net connectivity.
Okay, sir. Am I audible now, sir?
Yeah. We missed you once before. Yeah. You're audible.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. You're audible.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, every scientific finding should be documented, and patient will get benefit of whether it will be confirmed by.
Unfortunately, we've lost his net connectivity again. I don't have time to wait. So basically, every piece of scientific information should be reported. That is my take on that. And I think Dr. Tomar also started with that. Now, what happens is, if you have documented and reported it, it gives an, you know, if the clinician can refer the patient to an expert, to, because the whole essence about these markers is, yes, they are non-significant if they are isolated. So the whole most important thing is to confirm that they are isolated. And at times, yes, you need, you know, if somebody is not you know, that experience, then the, you know, if they have documented it, at least then the patient has a chance to go to an expert and to confirm that it is isolated. And definitely autonomy of the patient in making decisions should be respected. So you can document it. You can also should write down an explanation for that. If there is an echogenic intracardiac focus, you'd say that there is an echogenic intracardiac focus, but at the same time, at the bottom of the report, you can write down that an echogenic intracardiac focus in this case is an isolated finding. As an isolated finding, it does not increase the baseline risk of aneuploidy. It does not, you know, it is otherwise not clinically significant. And so, you know, that kind of an explanation can be given along with that. So the take home message is that soft markers are independent markers of aneuploidy. In low risk pregnant women, most of the markers do not significantly alter the priority risk. Detection of any marker should prompt a detailed USG and to look for other markers. That is the most important message here. Of course, if NIPT is done, then we don't modify it. Such markers such as EICF, mild hydronephrosis, isolated short femur, choroid plexus cyst. Now, if these are all isolated and there are other screening tests have been normal, FTS, then the patient's risk is the same. And so the patient, actually the fetus, is not at risk because of these markers. Then the fetus has the maximum risk to the fetus is because of the lack of knowledge of people involved. And usually these days, every family has got one doctor who could be anyone. And then, you know, if they are not aware about what is the meaning of this marker, because somebody may say a choroid plexus cyst is something in the brain, they may feel it's a brain tumor. So we don't want these pregnancies to get terminated because of these subtle findings. And that is the reason it is very important that we need to counsel the patient. Counseling is the most important thing. And as Dr. Apurba said, we need to tell them that this is okay. This is coming as 1 in 200. We take it as high risk, but still 199 of these are going to be normal. And hence, we just need to get an invasive testing done, and we need to rule that out. If there is something, we will think about it. If there's nothing else, yes, you know, most of these babies are going to do absolutely well. So in a nutshell, make sure that the marker is truly isolated before saying so. Just don't feel that an EICF or a choroid plexuses, yes, they are non-significant things. They are non-significant only if you have ruled out everything else. I've seen cases of, you know, choroid plexuses reported as non-significant. The patient comes to you for another scan and you find that, yes, there was an associated single umbilical artery. There was a unilateral club foot. There was a small VSD. There was a clenched fist. All these things probably otherwise would have been missed. But when they're all put together, they go in favor of trisomy 18. And if they're isolated, please counsel the patient, talk to them in the most compassionate manner, tell them everything. And of all these screening things that you have, we all realize that FTS is, yes, amongst all, the most sensitive of all. And so we need to promote first trimester screening. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, all panelists. You've been wonderful. And I think we've been able to send the right message across to everyone as regard this is concerned.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Thank you very much, sir.
How do I unshare my... Back to you, Mohit. Mohit, you have to unmute yourself.
Unmute yourself.
No, I was, I couldn't unmute. I would rather, Dr. Khurana is here, so I would like his comments on today's program. I personally feel all three panels were excellent, and what was the most interesting aspect of this was we discovered so many jewels today from the Northeast. All of them were excellent. I congratulate each one of you for giving your inputs and coming into the mainstream. Thank you very much. Dr. Khurana's comments are highly solicited, sir.
Thank you. And it's been an evening of great learning. The chat box is full of compliments, and I can understand why. I thought I might take a short break during one of the panel discussions. I couldn't get my eyes off my laptop screen. I kept this on so there'd be no interruptions. And it was truly an excellent experience. Three fabulous presentations, three fabulous panels, three excellent moderators. And the way we've expanded and made this into a teaching program, I think it's been absolutely phenomenal. But truly the most marvelous thing was the way we have realized that there is just so much talent all over this country. We are just so brilliant in our minds that I think we beat the whole world at it. And I'm truly proud to be able to be a part of this organization, which has grown so much in the past so many months. My congratulations to the Assam chapter for putting the entire Northeast together. And we look forward to a very, very vibrant year ahead. Thanks so much for a marvelous evening.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for those kind words. And I would request Dr. Gina Deka, the secretary of Assam chapter, to have the closing words, please.
Thank you, Dr. Mohit. And thank you, Dr. Khurana, sir, for those kind words and your encouragement always. It has been a wonderful evening of great academics and learning. And I would always say that teamwork makes the dream work. And first of all, I would like to thank all the extraordinary teachers of SFM, of Central SFM, Dr. Ashok Khurana, sir, Dr. TLN Praveen, sir, Dr. Bimal Sahani, sir, Dr. Mohit Shah, sir, for the constant guidance and encouragement regarding the academic activities of our chapter. And thank you, Khurana, sir, and Dr. Mohit, for having this vision of reaching out to every state of the Northeast and, for bringing people into the mainstream. And thank you, Dr. Mohit, for your constant guidance in helping me get this together. And thank you to our president of Assam chapter, Dr. Shamburwa, sir, and vice president, Dr. Apurva Bhatta, sir, for your constant leadership and constant guidance. And thanks to Dr. Gokuldas, sir, the president of the Northeast Associations of Obs and Gynae Societies, for your constant support in collaborating this with SFM. And finally, all the speakers, panelists, and moderators of our three case discussions, the delegates who has been so patient and has taken time out on a weekday to listen and attend this. And finally, the trade partners, GE LifeCell and Dr. Lal's PathLab, for your support. And I can never, you know, end this vote of thanks without thanking Mr. Vishal Mittal for his technical support and coordination always. I mean, this webinar has truly been a grand success, and I thank you all for this, and we hope to continue with our academic endeavors. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Good night. Good night, yes, everyone.
Thank you. Good night.
See you soon. Maybe we'll have one more session, maybe in another 2 months. You never know.
Yes.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Good night.